welcome to Real Shame. It's a twice, sometimes more week show where we look at movies from our movie list of shame or movie blind spots. I'm Adam.
I'm Andy.
And as we've been saying for the last couple weeks, since it's the season of scare and fright, we're giving you more episodes about horror movies. And this week is no exception. So it's no surprise to anybody who's been watching for a while that one of our favorite movies is John Carpenter's The Thing. But it's a remake, and it's a movie that I haven't seen before. Have you seen it?
I've seen it once. This is my second time to see it.
So we're going to jump back into the 50s and look at
The Thing from Another World.
Well, what are we doing now? Defrost him?
Well, this ice will melt pretty soon.
Doctor, can you control the heat in this room?
No, Captain. This is our storeroom. The temperature is constant here.
It won't be necessary to melt the ice. We can probably chip it away.
I'm sorry, Professor. We're not going to melt it or chip it. Eddie, open that window, will you?
You mean we're not allowed to examine it?
I mean, just that, Doctor.
This is stupid.
A scientist.
And Dr. Carrington's in charge here.
Hey, Pat, these windows don't open.
It's practically certain we'll be asked by your superiors to make a study of it.
Probably will, Doctor, but we can't permit it now.
We don't have to have any permission.
Eddie, break that window.
All right.
Sorry, I already pulled one boner out there in the ice. I'll admit I know anything about this, but until I receive instructions from my superior officer on what to do, we'll just have to mark time.
Captain, you have no authority.
I'd like to talk about it further. We better do it in the corridor. It's going to get pretty cold in here.
It's based on a novella that's called Who Goes There? It came out in 1938. The movie itself, The Thing from Another World, came out in 1951. It was directed by a man named Christian Nivey, and it was produced by the legendary Howard Hawks, although there is a little controversy that maybe Howard Hawks directed a lot of it, or perhaps all of it. It's kind of like the Poltergeist thing with Tobe Hooper and Steven Spielberg. Steven Spielberg supposedly was just a producer on that film. Tobe Hooper directed it, but looks an awful lot like a Steven Spielberg film.
And we might be talking about Tobe Hooper a little bit later in the week.
We might be. I don't know. Frankly, don't care whether Christian Ivey directed it or whether Howard Hawks directed it. But again, Howard Hawks is a producer. Stars Kenneth Toby, who we just saw in The Howling. He's at the beginning of The Howling. He's the older cop of the two cops that go in and rescue Dee Wallace. A lot older in that movie, a lot younger in this movie. He plays Captain Patrick Hendry. It's got Margaret Sheridan playing Nikki Nicholson. She's basically Captain Patrick's love interest.
Yeah.
Robert Cornthwaite plays the scientist, Dr. Carrington, and James Arness, who is probably most well-known as Matt Dillon in the TV show Gunsmoke. All 6'7" of him plays The Thing.
Oh, cool.
From Another World.
Yeah, The Thing was huge in this movie.
Yeah, he's a big guy. So I've seen this film before. This is my second viewing. So before I say what I thought of it or what I think of it, what were your impressions of The Thing?
And I think we're going to do like we've been doing, where we're going to try to save spoilers towards the end.
Sure.
Even though this movie is super old. So, you know, like I said in the intro, I hold John Carpenter's The Thing in pretty high regard. And the hardest part in watching this movie is trying not to constantly compare it to The Thing in my head, like while I'm watching it. So I'm trying to just like kind of put that in the back of my mind and watch the movie and take it in for what it is kind of stuff. And it was difficult. It wasn't an easy task for me to do. But overall, I thought the movie was pretty good. It seemed to be more interested in the interactings and intergoings of the characters than it is about this thing from another planet that is like the titular character, I guess.
Yeah.
So I feel like this has been an ongoing theme for kind of the movies we've been talking about so far. It's just like I wanted more interactions with the thing. And not to talk about it too much, but I feel like you don't get a whole lot of the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, there's probably reasons for that and stuff like that, but I kind of wish it was that took up a larger portion of the movie than it ended up taking up. So I really liked the main character and Margaret, Kenneth and Margaret, I think. I liked their interactions a whole lot. I thought it was because he's the pilot, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I thought that was cool. And I really liked seeing them on screen. And I kind of got like a His Girl Friday kind of vibe. Like she was very sharp and they kind of had some really cool back and forth. But so overall, I thought it was good. I just kind of wish it had more things from Another World. So what do you think?
I'm the same way, actually. Because obviously I saw Carpenter's remake before I saw this film. And like you said, I think it's very, very hard to divorce the two.
Yep.
And you can't help but compare. I think, again, this is a good movie. I'm just not super, super enthusiastic about it. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that I just love the John Carpenter version. I mean, I feel like it's okay to compare the two because they're taken from the same source material. And Carpenter's movie has, first of all, amazing special effects. Yes. It's got such a great level of suspense and tension and dread. And even when the thing is not around in the 1982 version, you've got all these guys suspicious of each other and you know, like testing their blood and doing all this crazy stuff that makes it just so interesting. Like you said, in this original film, when the thing's not around, it kind of slows down. The movie, I don't want to say it's boring necessarily, but it's just very slow.
And he doesn't feel like an ongoing menace. It's just like not all of a sudden all. He like shows up and is like, okay, we have to take care of this. And then he like takes a break for 15 minutes.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's like, no, he's back. We got to worry about this guy again. It's not like in, you know, the Carpenter's thing where you're constantly worrying about this, or like in slasher movies where even though the slasher is on screen, you still feel him like in the background kind of doing stuff. It feels like literally this guy just like disappears into another dimension, then reappears and all that kind of stuff.
I couldn't agree more. When I was watching this, I was thinking, okay, I don't expect this to have the gory, crazy special effects that the 1982 version does, but I do expect it to have a level of menace, a level of suspense, a level of dread, a level of tension. It doesn't really have any of those things. As you just said, when the thing is not on screen, they're kind of just going about their daily business. They don't even seem that concerned.
No,
I mean, they are, you know, they're looking for him and stuff, but I would be a lot more worried and a lot more scared. And they're just kind of like still kind of playing grab ass occasionally, like bicker or not bickering with each other, but just kind of playfully ribbing each other and stuff while this thing is lurking around, potentially like, going to kill them.
It's like you guys just unearth an alien and you're just like, oh, well. Yeah. Not our problem kind of stuff. It's like, what? There's an alien running around, guys.
Right. I do agree with you. I like the fact, because obviously in the Carpenter version, there's no female presence at all. There is in the prequel with Mary Elizabeth Winstead, the Thing prequel, but there's none in the Carpenter version. So I do like the fact that he does kind of have a love interest. And as you said, she gives as good as she gets with him. I mean, she's very kind of playful and gives him a lot of shit or whatever, you know, gives him a lot of guff. So I like their interaction. That stuff was cool to see. But yeah, when the thing is not on screen, you're kind of like, come on, let's pick up the pace, guys.
For sure. I think, and I also think there's a lot of parallels that kind of happen between, you know, obviously since John Carpenter's is loosely based off of this, it's interesting kind of see those things. And the big thing that jumped out to me was the way the title sequence is rendered in both of them.
Yeah.
Are it's like, whoa, like that that caught me off guard, but that was like a really cool feeling that, you know, both the way the title is rendered on the screen is very similar to an obviously a callback. So I thought, you know, and there's other parts pieced through it too, but I thought that was very cool.
Yeah. I mean, again, I would say, I guess the best way to summarize my feelings about this movie is I think it's good. I think it's, you know, it's technically well made. It's competent. And I think if you are a fan of the 1982 version, you owe it to yourself to watch this at least once just to kind of see how you feel. But don't be surprised if you really like the 1982 one, if you find this one maybe a bit lacking. And I can totally understand, you know, because I don't know that I necessarily know anybody personally, but there's a lot of people that consider this 1951 version, you know, just an absolute classic. It's, you know, one of their favorite science fiction movies. I totally get that. That's fine. I mean, if you feel that way, I don't particularly feel that way, but I don't, you know, I don't think that's not valid.
Yeah.
But I don't get as enthusiastic about this movie as I get, you know, about the John Carpenter one. I love the John Carpenter one. This one I like as a friend.
Yeah.
I friend zoned this one. So.
We did. This one's on the friend ladder.
But I mean, and also, you know, I don't think you can say that, oh, well, it's because it's the 1950s, it's not as good or whatever, because I can think of several other 1950s science fiction movies that I think are better than this. One being like The Day the Earth Stood Still. I think that's a better film. I think there's more kind of, again, not to say this film is bad, but I think there's more 1950s science fiction films that are a little bit more watchable, I guess, if that makes sense, than this is. Again, not bad, not a bad film, just not super over the moon about it. Doesn't blow my hair back.
Yeah, I'm in the same boat. I'm pretty sure this is probably average, maybe a little bit above average from 50 standards. of, you know, this kind of sci-fi movie. And then, you know, we had the A2 thing, which is probably maybe one of the best horror films ever made. Definitely probably top 10 for sure. So, you know, it's kind of hard, you know, having those two compare, but just because you like one doesn't mean you can't like the other and all that kind of stuff. So I'm on the same boat as you. I just, like you said, just kind of, it's a little bit different to kind of settle into. It's hard to separate the two. Thought it was good, but definitely could have been, you know, give us more antics with the thing. Give us more thing.
And it's funny, you know, obviously the John Carpenter remade it in 1982. And obviously he's a fan of the original one because in Halloween from 1978, it's on TV. The little kid, Tommy Doyle, and the girl that Jamie Lee Curtis are babysitting are watching The Thing from Another World on television.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. It is 89% fresh, 73% audience score. Leonard Maltin gives it 3.5 stars. But Leonard Maltin only gave the Carpenter version 1.5 stars.
Oh, I wonder if do you think he's ever would revisit that?
I don't know. I think the review said something like the special effects are gross and icky, and that's about all it has going for it, which I think is completely wrong.
Yeah.
He gave the prequel, the 2011, I think it was 2011 prequel, 2 stars. So apparently he's not a fan of
the thing,
the later thing stuff, first one he really likes.
And I'm hot on the prequel sequel. I like that one a lot.
I do too. Yeah, I think the 82 version and the prequel are both pretty good. Siskel and Ebert don't have a review of this because this is way before their show, and I didn't find any kind of Roger Ebert print review of it. So gotcha. All you get is Leonard Maltin, 3.5 stars.
Come on. All right, spoilers.
Spoilers.
I feel like we covered a lot of the whole movie, so I don't know if there's a lot left for spoilers. I did, for the carnivorous plants drinking blood and all that stuff, I did get a Little Shop of Horrors vibe from that. Yeah. Especially with the scientists and stuff. Like, it just felt very, like, Little Shop to me.
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't know if you really needed the menace of the scientist with the menace of, you know, the thing running around.
You don't. The fact that, because he doesn't start off as really a bad character. Yeah. He just seems like a man of science. And then, of course, towards the end, they kind of make him almost villainous in a way.
Like almost mustache twirling villainous.
He's like, oh, we owe it to ourselves to let this thing kill us in the name of science. Because we can't kill this thing. It needs to survive and be studied. And it's like, nah, dude, you're crazy. I ain't letting this thing kill me. And kill you.
And I thought it was hilarious that, like, the way it got out of its ice tomb was the electric blanket.
I wrote that down. I put hysterical idiot because I was thinking that, because not only does he put an electric blanket on there not realizing that it's gonna heat up the ice, but then he runs out with a gun and points it directly at the captain for like 30 seconds until the captain's like, get the gun out of my face or whatever. That guy's just a complete idiot. I wouldn't want that guy on the base with me at all. He's going to shoot somebody.
But, you know, we had stuff with, like, blood, and then obviously, like, the blood thing takes, you know, you have the plants, the plants love to drink blood in this movie, and then we have that awesome, you know, blood scene in the 82's The Thing. You know, you have, like, the dogs kind of stuff like that. You know, you see dogs in this movie, and then, you know, you have the dog scene in the later one. I like them, you know, discovering, like, the spacecraft and then unearthing it and stuff like that. Like, I could see this kind of being, you know, playing into a little bit of the John Carpenter's thing, and, you know, saw where he kind of picked those pieces. So it was a lot of fun just kind of being like, oh, yeah, I can see echoes of this or mirrors of this kind of later on and stuff like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And it was those pieces that he kind of picked that are obviously the most interesting things about the movie. For sure. Like when the alien does come in and they set it on fire and they practically set the whole room on fire, that stuff's exciting.
Yeah.
So when that happens, you're like, hell yeah. Or when he opens the door and the thing's right there and he kind of smashes the side or whatever, all that stuff, I'm like, yeah, more of that.
When they throw the stick and he just jumps, the thing jumps.
That was great. Yeah, he's trying to get him on the ramp or the little board so that they can electrocute him at the end. And, you know, in this one, he's not a shapeshifter at all. And apparently in the novella, I've never read the novella, but apparently in the novella, it is also a shapeshifter.
Oh, okay, cool.
Everything that I've ever read is that Carpenter's version is a lot more faithful to the novella than this one is.
Interesting.
But in this one, they make him basically a plant monster almost.
Yeah, which is like, I guess in the 50s.
So you can shoot him, but that's not going to really hurt him because it's like shooting a plant. If you set a plant on fire and burn it to a crisp, I mean, obviously the plant's not going to be no more. And so it's the same way with him. They have to electrocute him or burn him or do something like that. Because even when he gets dismembered, because part of his arm gets taken off by, I guess, one of the dogs, right? Yeah. But they are able to take seeds from his arm, and that's how they create the little blood plants yeah. or whatever. So it's a little bit different thing than the 1982 version. And obviously the fact, you know, shape-shifting and all that stuff, just to me, is way cooler than a walking plant man or whatever.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Totally agree. Yeah, I think the ongoing menace that you get from John Carpenter's The Thing is that you don't know who it is or what it is, and maybe it doesn't know what it is or who it is, you know?
Yeah.
And so you have that ongoing presence, and this movie is just like, he comes in and, like, tears down a door, and then he leaves and takes a break, and then he comes back and cuts the power to a room and stuff like that, and it's like, you couldn't get a feel for, like, how intelligent it was and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But I thought it looked cool. I mean, I'm glad they got a really tall guy to play him and stuff like that, and he looked menacing.
Yeah.
At least his render on screen, so... That was anything else you want to add?
No.
All right.
I think we've covered it.
Covered it. So that was our review on Thing from Another World. You know, if you've seen it, it's what am I trying to say? If you've seen it, that's cool. If you haven't, maybe you should check it out. It's worth watching at least once. And
I think so.
Let us know in the comments how you feel about Thing from Another World. Write down if it's good or if it's bad. Write down if you have any theories about plant-based monsters that are coming up and taking people to our space.
Or I want to hear from people that think that this one is better than the 82 one.
Oh, that'd be cool, yeah.
I'd be interested to know. I'm sure there are people that think that. Yeah. I'd be interested in that, to see their take on it.
Let us know. We would love to read those. And you can shoot us an email to realshame@gmail.com. Follow us on social media @realshame on Instagram. And stay tuned as we give you more horror movies from our list of shame. And we'll see you next time, guys. Bye.
Keep watching the skies.
Ooh.